It's a comedy show show, and it's gonna be your favorite new show. And if you don't know, oh, whoa, you really must go. Cause it's the best live shows in the nation, with the funniest minds that create them. You'll be like, how the hell have I not heard about this before? Yo, it's a comedy show show.
Hi, I'm Kevin Allison, and this is Risk, the show where people tell true stories they never thought they'd dare to share. And tonight we're at the Bell House in Brooklyn, which is our home here in New York. We love doing shows here. Tonight's theme is messy. All of these stories tonight are kind of shit shows. there's going to be a lot of... spills and falls and that sort of thing in tonight's stories. And I think you're gonna enjoy tonight's show.
Howdy, 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 Brooklyn. How's everyone doing tonight? Awesome. Welcome to Risk. How many people here are already familiar with the podcast? Awesome. Well, if you don't know, if you were drugged and then drug here, like if your friend is the Bill Cosby of bringing people to storytelling shows, I mean, that would be problematic, but a lot nicer than the real Bill Cosby, I think. You know, look at the bright side. No, if you don't know, Risk is the show where people tell true stories they never thought they'd dare to share in public. So these are the kind of stories that you're not gonna hear on national public radio, right? These are the kind of stories that are a little bit too kinky or too violent or too emotional or just too crazy for the regular radio. I'm gonna start us off tonight. I'm gonna tell a story. Now, this one is actually one of the very first stories I ever shared on Risk, but there's gonna be a little surprise attached, a little something new this time. I always start this by saying that psychologists say you should take a good look at your first memory because it might say something about you. You might be able to analyze it a little bit. And mine definitely says something about me. I'm about 3.5 years old. I'm crawling around looking at the shag fibers in the carpet in the dining room. And I have the first thought that I can remember having. And it was, wow, I really love boys' butts. And that has actually been every other thought that I've had since that Saturday afternoon. That's how I know it's a meaningful memory. But you know what? There's a curse in being a child who knows himself so well at such a young age, because I grew up in Cincinnati, Ohio in the 1970s, very Republican, very conservative, very Catholic. So there I was a kid being like, oh my God, I like boys' butts, but I've got to get out of this city. So I saw in Time magazine these pictures of gay bars in New York City, and I decided that's where I'm going to college. So I'm 18 years old, and by that time, you know, not having had any chance to try any of this gay stuff, I'm 18 years old, I'm at NYU, and I am very horny. I am ready to go. But here's the thing. I was also kind of intimidated because I didn't have any of the experience of like cruising. I didn't know where gay men congregated. So I thought, oh my gosh, you know what I should do? My very first week at NYU, I said, here's what I'll do. I'll go to the musical theater wing of the School of the Arts and just kind of eavesdrop. Like a little detective. And sure enough, of course, it's exactly what people were talking about. Within about 10 minutes of hanging around that musical theater department, I hear two guys and they're like, oh my God, you know what? There's this amazing bar where all the gay guys from Columbia University meet, and it's on West 82nd Street. And I'm like, oh my gosh, I found it. I found out where they congregate. So I literally wrote it down. They said, oh my gosh, they have to keep it super discreet, so there's no name of the place. It's called The Works, but they don't put the name out front. They just show a sign out front that shows plumbing. So, you know, like in and out of the pipes. So that's how you'll know you're there. So I was like, oh my God, great. I got myself a little packet of lube. Like an individual packet. I was like, I don't know how this whole hooking up things works, but I think you use this. So I got that. I took the subway up there and I'm like, this is it. This is gonna be my first gay experience. Oh my gosh. But when I walked in the bar, I immediately got so scared because I saw that everyone was so cute. You know, that's the thing. It's very intimidating to be around other gay guys because, you know, I was born with the queer, but not so much the I, you know? So I was immediately intimidated. But the guy at the door said, here, I'm gonna give you this little bracelet and it's all you can drink Pabst Blue Ribbon tonight. And I was like, oh my God, thank goodness. That's when my life raft right there. So I go in and I start drinking and I'm thinking, gosh, yeah, this is competitive. I'm watching guys compete with guys for other guys. I've always associated guys competing for things with horror, right? So here I was like, oh no, now this men competing with men thing is going on here, but it's for each other. So I was like, all right, I'm just gonna sit in a corner and drink and occasionally force myself to, oh my gosh, yes, I should really talk to him. And then wuss out and then drink a little bit more and think, oh my God, yeah, I gotta jump up and say hello to him, but then watch another guy walk away with him. I just kept drinking until finally I thought, Kevin, just get yourself up off this bar stool, put one foot in front of the other, and say hello to somebody. Something's bound to happen. So I got myself up that bar stool, and then a tsunami wave of drunken nausea just engulfed me, and I thought, oh no, I'm not talking to anybody here. I've gotta get out of here. So now I'm kind of like, you know, a bear on a unicycle trying to get myself out of this place. I'm clawing my way through people and I finally get to that door and I can smell the fresh air and I've escaped. And I said to myself, okay, Kevin, your first evening ever of trying to hook up with someone was just, let's say, sad. That was sad, you know? But you're brand new, you're only 18, you're brand new and your whole life is ahead of you. So just cut your losses and head home. But I thought, you know what? Before I do that, let me sober up a little and just walk around the block. So I'm kind of walking around the block and suddenly I see across the street this big black void, this empty space. I was used to seeing buildings all around in New York City, but there's nothing going on there. And I thought, oh my gosh, this must be the place they refer to as the Central Park. And haven't I heard rumors that gay men also congregate in that park at night where they have anonymous sexual encounters? Well, I'm here to tell you, they do. However, that happens at a very particular spot in the park, right? And I was nowhere near there. I'm thinking to myself, gosh, you know, I don't know where that happens. So how do I go about this? Then I think to myself this, look, it's 3:30 at night, right? It's kind of dangerous to go into that park. If I see another person who happens to be of the male gender walking through that park at 3:30, he is surely either on his way to or fro a forest sex party. So why don't I just look for him to be my wise guide? So, off I go, into the woods, into the dark, right? Now, I have to have a little caveat at this point in the story, because when I tell it to straight folks and gay folks, I get different reactions here, right? My gay friends, they're very used to, at least maybe themselves, having had lots of strange anonymous encounters in weird places, or a lot of friends who have had them. So they're used to this story being of the comedy genre. Whereas straight folks only hear this sort of story from the media, and those stories always end with chainsaws and chloroform. So, at this point, I can usually feel people thinking, oh no, don't tell us you were murdered. Well, it wasn't quite that bad, but it wasn't very good either. About 60 seconds in, I'm like, oh my gosh, I don't know how to get back out of this park. I forgot the breadcrumbs. I was like, wait a minute. Before I get any more lost, let's revisit my logic from earlier. If I should happen to see a man walking through this park at 3:30 in the morning, he's surely going to or fro a forest sex party. Couldn't I just stay put and maybe have some fun just with him when he comes through? Right? Skip the whole big, you know, group thing, it's just him and me. I'm just gonna wait for him. So why don't I just hide in a little bunch of bushes. And then when he comes down the walkway, all I gotta do is shimmy my branches. And when he sees the shimmy shimmy, he's gonna think, what, is that another person of the male gender? Obviously, it's time to get our dicks out. Perfect plan. So there I was. I'm in the bushes. I'm ready to do my shimmy shimmy. And guys, within about 5 minutes, I am not kidding you, a guy comes down the walkway, and it's all kind of foggy. And as I'm looking closer, I'm like, wait a minute, that looks like a really nice, like Brooks Brothers kind of suit. And that looks like a really nice briefcase. Maybe he's not so much dressed for a sex party. Maybe he's just really late from work. But you know what? I gotta do what I gotta do. I'm here to shimmy. So I gave those branches a little shimmy, right? And he stops and he looks, and clearly he's thinking, is that some dude in the bushes? Then he sees, yeah, it really is. And he runs out of there. He is out of there as quickly as possible. So now I'm sitting there with my branches and I'm like, Kevin, all right. Before, at the bar, that was just sad, right? But this, in the bushes, this is pathetic. All right, you gotta give up on this hooking up with someone tonight plan, because it's getting worse. So just cut your losses and go home. But then I thought, you know what? I would like to just rest just a tiny bit, right? Of course, there will be no sleeping. There will be no sleeping. I'm just gonna sit down, kind of lie back in the branches for a moment. I wake up about an hour and a half later. And I'm like, whoa, what? Wait, oh my, I'm in Central Park. I'm in the bushes. Oh, yes. Okay. And as I begin to stand up, I notice that it's a little wet under my feet. And as I look down, I see, holy shit, someone has taken my sneakers. I don't know how they found me in the bushes to start with. But they did, and they absconded with my shoes. And I love that part of the story because I get to say absconded. Nevertheless, I thought to myself, okay, the bar was sad, okay? The bushes was pathetic. This now is fiasco, right? This is where the bad things that are happening no longer have any connection to cause or effect. It's just insanity. This is like the apocalypse now of trying to hook up with someone. So please, Kevin, end the evening, cut your losses, get out of here. So I get out of the park, and I'm like, I've got to get a subway home. And I found a subway station, and I thought, oh my gosh, I've got my little token in my pocket, and I'm going to get this thing. Because, you know, the thing is, if you miss one at 5 o'clock in the morning, it might take you another hour till another one comes. So I run, and the train is kind of whirring, and it's kind of coming to a stop. But then that tsunami of drunken nausea comes over me again. Right, and I'm like, oh dear God. And I find myself, as the train slows down, leaning against the door frame, and then it goes, boom, boom, and I explode into the train. Now, there's like 6 people on this car, right? And they're all looking at me like, what the fuck? Who vomits into the train? I'm like, holy shit, I have no time to be self-conscious about this. I've got to jump on this goddamn train or I'll miss it. So I jump on, momentarily forgetting that my feet are very slick. And it's also rather slick right beneath me, so I go, whoop! My feet are parallel to my shoulders, and then, bam! Down in my own mess. And now all 6 people are at the very far end of the car. And I thought, okay, this is clearly the cherry on top. This is the end of the evening. So I just waved to them, like, hello and good night. Now, that's the way that story went for years. But there's a big old lie right in the middle of it. And here's why. When we started Risk in August of 2009, the whole idea was that this was a show where no one had to censor themselves, right? You could be as kinky or emotional or scary or whatever as you really felt befitted the truth of what you lived through. So I wasn't yet familiar enough with how the audience would react to some of this stuff. So I wussed out when I shared this story that second week of Risk, right? And put a big lie right in the middle. Because the truth is, that well-dressed man in the Brooks Brothers coming through that park, I blew that motherfucker. I have a little tip for you. I can tell you from experience, if it's 3:30 in the morning and there's a man walking through Central Park, he's either going to or fro a forest sex party, and it is time to get your dicks out, my friends. Thank you very much. We have so many wonderful storytellers sharing on the show tonight. This is going to be so much fun. I'm thrilled to bring up our first guest, Julio Torres!
Hi. Hi. Hello. Hi. Hey. Hi. I remember that when I graduated school, I went to the New School here in New York. And if you know anything about the New School, this makes sense. It's like, yes. Yeah. When I graduated from the New School, all I wanted, all I hoped for, was to get a 9-to-5 job. That would pay for being alive in New York. That is all I wanted. And I thought, well, I got good grades, so job, here I come. Because I was very smart, but also very stupid. So I thought, well, you know, I'm ready for a job. So I of course, I tried applying. Oh. Mind you, I was graduating with a literary studies degree. So I did what I think everyone does, which is, you know, you email any like professor that was ever nice to you, and you're like, hey, so Julio, I was in your like Kafka in architecture class. Just wondering if there are any dogs I can walk. But no, I wasn't quite desperate yet. And I tried for like the publishing jobs and nothing. I never got an interview, and then I tried anything vaguely related to what I wanted to do. Then I decided to do something, well, dare I say, risky. Here it comes, you can all guess. I went to the, what's that quote in The Lion King? To that kingdom, to that part of the kingdom where the light doesn't, Craigslist. I went to Craigslist. Mordor from Lord of the Rings, yeah. And then I was still delusional because I went to the like writing slash editing section of Craigslist. And I thought, well, you know, I might be going to like this scary neighborhood, which is Craigslist, but I'll go to like the nice part in the scary neighborhood. I'll go to the writing editing section. And then I see this ad that says, looking for PG-friendly stories about tickling. And I'm thinking, well, this might be, you know, maybe it's like ghostwriting a children's book. And I write back, and I'm like, well, what kind of, you know, I graduated from this school, and I just, I can write a story about tickling, sure. Like, the worst stories in life involve a he, or are caused by a he. And he wrote back saying, okay, so what I'm looking for is just like fun guys like yourself to videotape yourself talking straight to camera, no nudity, no lewd language, talking straight to camera, just about how much you love being tickled. And I thought, oh no, I'm definitely in the like the bad part of town now. But then it almost felt like a challenge, because you should know that I hate being tickled. I mean, I don't. Maybe I don't hate it, but I think I have the average person's reaction to it, which is, this is annoying, why is it happening? So I thought, oh well, what a fun challenge. And it paid, I think it paid like $100 per 5 minute video. And you're thinking, oh, that's, you're making $100 every 5 minutes? Well, no, because to get 5 minutes of footage that I was satisfied with, that was like a day, right? So I did the first one, and immediately I just slip into this sort of like it's like all American guy character. So I just start talking about like, oh, you know, like my big brother, I don't have a big brother. Like my big brother, he would just pin me down to the floor and he'll tickle me and he'd be like, huh, I'm the tickle monster, who's the tickle monster? And I had to be like, huh, you're the tickle monster. But then I just went to college and I got stronger and stronger, and I came back home and then I pinned him down to the floor and I was like, who's the tickle monster now? He loved it. And I was so pleased. Because then you think, okay, so like the first one was like set at home, so like the sequel has to be college, right? So the sequel, I was me and like my buddies, we were gonna join a frat, and the initiation, fuck, it just tickled us all night. And he liked that one. And then I kind of got too ambitious, and I really phoned it in with the third one. That was just like, it was just about like, I was with a friend and he started tickling me or something like that. And yeah, I got too cocky, because then he wrote back saying, this is no longer working for me. I don't know that I'll ever heal from that. So I had to, you know, move on. And then I replied to this other Craigslist ad that said, looking for a magician's assistant. And I thought, well, that's just fun. But the first question I asked in the email, the first, and I think the only thing that I asked is, does the assistant have to be female? Or can we just like open our minds and this be like a really like fun thing? Like, can I be the first male? I don't know if I would be the first male magician's assistant, but I was like, oh, maybe I'll get a job and make some history while I'm at it. So he writes back like, no, very like choppy sentences. Like, no, that's okay, meet me for an interview, and then like, the address of a cafe in Soho. And then I go into the cafe, and then I realized, oh, I don't know what this magician looks like. But then I see a gentleman in all black in a fedora. And I think, oh, okay, good. So I sit down with him, and he's with this woman who's just sort of like, her face was just grumpy. She was just like either bored or tired. She was just like, and not saying, and I like said hi to her, and then like, we never got introduced, but like I never got her name or anything. She was just like there. And the magician, the first thing he says is, I am not magician. And it was like, well, uh-huh. Please do go on. And he has this very, he's a little surly, but he's very, you can tell that he's like translating from his native language a lot. So he sounds very pensive, and he's just taking his time with every sentence. He goes, I am not a magician. I am a saxophone player. And I'm thinking, well, clearly you know the name for the thing you do, so why not looking for a saxophone player assistant? Like, why are we hiding that you're a saxophone player? That's okay. In fact, I guarantee more and better responses than a magician's assistant. Like, I'm the only one like stupid and weird enough to reply to a magician's assistant ad. Or if you're like a saxophone player, like a lot of people wouldn't mind doing that. But he's just like, I am a saxophone player. I'm like, okay. He's like, I have a saxophone. I'm like, uh-huh. Yes. Great, you're not like renting. I have a saxophone. And I play at parties. Like, okay. People are laughing. People are having fun. It is a wedding. It is a retirement. It's a birthday. They're having fun. I am playing saxophone. They're laughing. I keep playing saxophone. Any song, Madonna. They're laughing. And then dick comes out. I'm like, why? I'm like, why? You just said that people were already having fun. These people are at a retirement party, you just said. And then dick comes out. It doesn't seem like anyone was asking for dick. he goes, no, no, no. I have special saxophone. I push a button, and from the hole in the saxophone, like a dick, plastic dick, comes out. And from the dick, tequila, vodka, and people laugh, they drink. And I'm still like a little hung up on like why magician's assistant. It's just a lie after a lie after a lie. And I was like, well, okay. And then his wife interrupts for the first time. She hasn't said anything. She leans over and she sort of like sees me becoming less and less interested in the job. She leans over and she goes, only saxophone in the world that can do this. She is, I think, sick and tired of defending this man. He's like, I believe in him, he made it. The dick comes out, I'm sick and tired of explaining it to everyone what my husband does. And I asked like, well, what would I do? What do you need me for? And essentially what he wanted was someone to get him booked for parties. And he, I think, wanted to charge something like $300 or $400 an hour for the saxophone. And then he goes, but no one can know about Dick. Dick must be surprise for everyone. So not even the person paying for the service, not even the person throwing the party can know that that will happen. I thought about it for a little bit, like, maybe I can be the booker. But of course it didn't happen, and it was just like yet another job I didn't succeed getting. But that was not my fault. Now I just do this. I just do comedy. But which seems so much easier than getting a 9-to-5 job. Like, I'll never figure out how to, if you're looking for one, good luck. I don't have any pointers. Just be a star. Go become a star. Because I don't know how to guide you. But thank you. Thank you so much. Bye.
Julio Torres.
All right. I want to bring our next storyteller out to the stage. Please welcome to the stage, Josh Gondelman!
Thank you. Guys, thank you so much for having me. What a pleasure it is to be here amongst you. I'm going to tell you a story about how I came to invent my one-of-a-kind saxophone. Good night. No. So I moved to New York City about 5 years ago, and it was a very alienating experience for me. I didn't feel like I belonged. I felt out of place everywhere, and everything just felt like kind of more of a struggle than it should have been. I felt lonely, even though I had friends and was in a relationship, and I felt unsure of myself, even though I knew what I'd come here to do, and I had felt very good when I moved here, and it just kind of rattled me. And I want to tell you a story about how I came to feel at home in this city. And maybe this will make you guys feel a little better if you ever have these kind of moments of alienation and loneliness. And the story happened on the subway, which is like the crucible of humanity in New York City. Like, it really tests what you're made of as a person, and you come out different on the other side of every trip. I was just in London for 3 days, which is 5 days American, and London is like a huge metropolitan city, but in a lot of ways it's kind of quaint and old-timey compared to New York, specifically because of the public transportation. In London, they have signs in all their subway stations warning you not to get too close to the platform edge. They say, mind the gap, right? Very charming logo, tourists buy it on t-shirts. In New York, for contrast, in all our subway stations, we have signs that say, in 2012, 141 people were struck by trains. 55 were killed. That's not even a warning. There's nothing there that tells you how to act. That's just us as a city boasting about how lethal our public transit is. Just like New York City, deadliest fucking trains on the planet. They're like cobras on steel tracks. So this story takes place almost 5 years ago, and it's late at night, and I'm getting onto the subway with my girlfriend at the time. And we step onto the subway, and as we're walking onto the train, I mention 19th century German Chancellor Otto von Bismarck. Because I know how to seal the deal. And we walk onto the train, and right across from us, there's a homeless gentleman asleep, standing up in the style of a horse. That's how they do it. That's how he did it. And that wasn't the moment that I felt at home. I wasn't like, let me join you, father, right? That's just where it starts. So we walk onto the train, and when I mention Otto von Bismarck, the 19th century Chancellor of Germany, he wakes up, stares me in the eyes, and engages me in debate. Like, we're a one-on-one debate society, and my time is up. And I expected him to have kind of the standard homeless gentleman voice, right? Like Tom Waits on his Tom Waitsiest day. But he didn't. He had this beautiful, rich baritone. And when he spoke to me, this is what he said, verbatim. He goes, there were no chancellors in those days. Otto von Bismarck was the king of Germany. He unified the Germanic people, but he scattered Africa. That is the legacy of Otto von Bismarck. Then he fell back to sleep, standing up, like Abraham Lincoln at Disney World's Hall of Presidents, leaving me to wonder, is that what he says to everyone that gets on the train? And I just brought up the topic he was gonna discuss anyway. I did not have to worry. My girlfriend woke him up to ask a follow-up question, which until that point was the thing I thought she only did to me. She says, excuse me, how did you have that knowledge at your fingertips, waking up from a dead sleep in that way? How did you come by this expertise? That was amazing. And he said, I studied in England. I studied in France. I was a professor here at Monroe College in the Bronx. But now, look at me. Here I am, homeless and an alcoholic, asleep on this train with my two ladies. And we look around, and there's nobody else on the train. Then he opens his jacket. He's got Jack Daniels on one side, Johnny Walker on the other, which to me didn't look like ladies, but gender's a spectrum, and I wasn't there to judge. Then he goes back to sleep, as if to suggest, this is kind of where I do this. Leave me alone. My girlfriend wakes him up again to ask one more question. She goes, what was it like living in Europe? Like, he just got back from a semester abroad and had to write an independent study essay. And he answered very graciously. He said, it was better there. There was healthcare for everyone. Here, if I'm sick, who knows what happens to me? But there, I see a doctor immediately. I thought that was really, like, an incredible, thoughtful answer given the circumstances. And the train stopped, and we got off, and I was just, like, blown away by how we'd completely written off this man's station in life and his perspective based on the way we met him, right? But he had this incredible breadth of knowledge and a depth of knowledge and a willingness to share it that I thought was really incredible and impressive, and it, like, kind of knocked me on my heels. And we get onto another train to transfer to go the rest of the way home. And I lived in, like, Hamilton Heights in Harlem, which is a very heavily Dominican neighborhood. Yeah, woo. It was a lovely place. And so there was, I think, a Dominican woman and her little six-year-old son, who's the cutest kid I've ever seen, and he's got a hat on that's the face of Bert from Sesame Street. And I look, I know, that's what I said. I was like, hey, man, that's a great hat. And he looks up at his mom, like, can I talk to the stranger? And she kind of nods, like, yeah, this nerd's not in any trouble. I can tell from the cardigan. It's the summer. And he looks up at me, and he says, thank you. And I say, you're welcome. And he's now emboldened, because I've spoken to him and I've engaged him, right? So he comes at me with a question. He goes, are you two the brother and the sister? And I was like, no. And then he says, why not? Which was a question I'd never considered the answer to. Certainly not in, like, a family-friendly way, right? Because my first instinct was just to be like, nah, dog, I smashed that on the regular, you heard? Pound it, son. But that can't be his sex talk. That's not my place. But I figured it out. I said, because we have different moms and dads. And that was enough for him. He was like, thank you. So the train stops, and we go to leave, and this little boy and his mom get up to leave. And he is so excited. He's like, this is my stop too. Perhaps I will see you tomorrow. And I was like, yeah, maybe. Because when you're like a 30-year-old dude with some of a beard, you can't make plans to hang out with the six-year-old you just met. That's not a playdate. That's like textbook Amber Alert. So I was like, yeah, maybe. But I was so charmed by this little kid, right? He was so open and curious and just soaking up the world like a sponge, just hungry for information and excited to learn about the world around him and the people around him. And that was so amazing. Just that we'd first met this man, right, who, again, we'd totally written off because of his position in society. Then we met this child who just had unlimited enthusiasm and boundless curiosity. And I thought, wow, that really, to me, represents the entire spectrum of human potential. I really thought that. And I said out loud to my girlfriend as we walked up the stairs to my apartment, I was like, I need to be a better person. I want to be a better citizen of this world, which that's not even a phrase. That just sounds like a Gap ad for HIV awareness. And I said that, and we get to my apartment, and the first thing I do is I turn on my laptop, and the first thing I do once my laptop boots up is I look up Otto von Bismarck. And the first thing I find out when I read that Wikipedia entry is, he was the fucking chancellor the entire time. I was like, that dick didn't even know what he was talking about. That little kid probably wasn't even a kid. He was probably a 45-year-old Mexican little person who likes to punk out white people on the subway. And at that point, I realized the lesson of that night wasn't that you should trust and embrace every point of view and seek out diverse experiences. It's that you should be glad you didn't go to Monroe College in the Bronx because their faculty is made up of lying drifters. It's the wrong lesson, but I learned it. Thank you guys so much. Good night.
Josh Gondelman! Our next storyteller, it's his first time ever doing Risk. It's great to have him here tonight. Please welcome to the stage, Kurt Metzger!
Thank you very much. All right, well, they told me a story is where you tell a story that you would never tell, ever, right? But I don't really have any of those. Like, I would just tell all my stories. But this story, a Comedy Central publicist asked me to stop telling on a publicity tour. So I guess you be the judge. But it was a long time ago, too. I was in my early 20s, and I had this one-nighter in Ottawa, Canada. I had two friends in common, this guy Tim that I rode up with and this guy Buddy who set the whole thing up. And it was for the animation festival, okay, because we were pitching a cartoon. And he set it up at this comedy club in Ottawa that we were going to do a comedy at the end of the, you know, end of the festival comedy show. So I had never met the other guy, Tim, who was driving. And I show up late. This guy Tim is a good friend of mine now, okay, but he just hated my guts when I met him. Because I showed up late and I slept most of the drive. Did you ever do that? Just be like a shitty car friend and not stay awake a little bit for like a 6-hour drive. I was like, pleased to meet you. Just right out. And we get up there and I was annoyed with this guy, Tim, because he had never been to Canada either. This is my first time going to Canada, okay? And it's not like going to Montreal or going to Vancouver or Toronto, someplace cool. This is Ottawa, their capital. It's just a blocky, stupid-looking place. It looks like, if you remember the game Grand Theft Auto 3, it looks like that. And I had a feeling that I could just grab someone out of their car and take the, and then just change my shirt and they would never catch me. Like, I had a very distinct feeling. It was like a Lego town, okay? So Tim's never been there. Now, if you've ever been going to Canada with someone who's ever been to Canada, there's some kind of person who like sucks up to Canada when they get there, okay? I don't know how, this is the best way to describe it. We get up there and everybody's like, oh, it's so much better. Like the second we get there, it's suddenly so much better. And we order breakfast and he gets Canadian bacon. He goes, oh, this bacon's so good. It's so much better than American bacon. It's just fucking ham, dickhead. He's just blowing every Canadian. And we go and do the show. Canada is a delightful place to perform. It's like, normally I go to Canada and I feel like when C-3PO was telling Ewoks about the Death Star, where he's like doing the sound effects, like, ooh, like they're very impressed easily. Okay, but this time the show didn't go too well for me. And I guess Ottawa, they're like more polite or something. What they are is passive aggressive, okay? Those of you from Minnesota or Wisconsin get that, right? And I don't do passive, I just do aggressive. So I'm just that kind of person that some people, you know, I don't have the ability not to be how I am. So you're gonna have to meet me halfway, and some people don't want to, and it creates friction, okay? So I did with this crowd, and but they were still very nice, right? Everybody, all the employees were like, oh, you guys were great, even though I totally stunk it up. And I had been drinking, and they go, is there anything we can get you? And I'm like, yeah, can you find me some blow? I want some blow. they might have not even been asking what I want, and I just said, find me some blow, if I'm being honest. Well, thinking back, I might have just blurted that out at just people. And so somebody ran and found cocaine for me. Like, in fact, now that I think about it, they didn't ask me. Before the show even started, I asked somebody for that. And while I was on, someone was out finding cocaine for me. And, but that's how, you know, I don't even drink anymore because I really never liked alcohol, I realized. I was just on coke, so that's why I drank. But at the time when I was doing that, you know, when you first start doing drugs, you get your first mood enhancer, and then you're like, you know what would make this even better? Some other shit, right? So that's what this story is that little balancing act, right, where you think you're going to fix the one thing and then you just create more problems and you have a mess. That's how this ended up. So this guy brings me cocaine. Oh, by the way, I'm staying in a penthouse, a Canada-style hotel penthouse. What an adorable concept of a penthouse. What a socialist bullshit penthouse. It was like one sizable room and I had to sleep on a trundle bed and Tim took the regular. They had a trundle bed in a penthouse, okay? So Tim had the regular bed because he had a back problem, where he said. So this employee brings me cocaine. I'm like, cool, let's get you some coke. And they're like, oh, we don't do that. None of the people that went and looked for cocaine for me did cocaine. It was just me. Think of that. That's how different it is in Canada. Just in New York, if you do cocaine, you gotta, no, we don't have coke. Get the fuck away from us. You gotta be like that, right? In Canada, they'll go get you coke that they don't want any part of. That's how nice they are. So, this coke, and I'm like, wait, is none of you guys gonna, I wanna do coke by myself, because that's just gonna be a real weird masturbation festival, right? I'm not trying to have that. I'm trying to have the other experience where you share way too much of your life with a stranger. So they're like, yeah, sorry, we don't do it. And then just from out of the darkness, this Canadian guy comes out like, I'll do coke with you, eh? And he said, eh. By the way, I met at least three people that said eh, like a stereotype. And you're like, oh, they don't all do that. These three people said eh after every word. And the guy goes, I'll do coke with you, eh? I'm like, all right, I don't know you. Come back to my hotel room with me. And he was a Canadian, like their version of the NFL. He was a Canadian football player. So, yeah. And who gives a shit? He'll do coke with me, so whatever. Okay? So me and this guy are sitting there just blowing line. By the way, how good is this coke going to be if I got it in Ottawa, Canada? How many times? And that's the reason I don't even do it anymore, because I'm sick of snorting baby laxatives and, you know, drywall. And but at this time, I'm an idiot in my life, so I'm like, yeah, fine, I'll just snort that. So I'm doing it. It feels awful, okay? I don't know what the fuck I'm snorting, but it feels terrible. But we're all wired up from it. Then Tim, the guy who I just drove up with, who hates my guts, walks in, sees a stranger he doesn't know, a little pile of cocaine. And the phone book open because my friend was like, let's get some whores, eh? Okay? I'm like, fuck yeah. I'm practically a rock star, okay? Of course we're gonna get some whores. That's the kind of drug it is, where you're like, yeah, let's get some whores. And then, meanwhile, your dick's not gonna work for whores, idiot. So he goes to the phone book. Tim just looks at us like disgusted and goes in the penthouse suite and shuts the doors. The other guy picks up the phone and orders two girls from his escort service. It was $1.50, which is pretty low, and the exchange rate was good at the time, so it was a deal, okay? They weren't from Ottawa, they were coming from Montreal, so that's a good deal. And I'm sitting there like, oh, all right, cool, getting some more. And I'm like, oh, wait, I'm on coke, how am I gonna do this? So the other guy, buddy, who set this show up, I knew he had Cialis, okay? So I'm like, I'll just go down to buddy's room, get some Cialis. Be ready for these hookers, right? So I go bang on his door. He won't answer the door. I'm like, why is he not answering? He knows I might need Cialis because I got coke. Bang on his door. Well, I didn't notice because we were just getting high for so long that it was 4 in the morning and he was dead asleep. So he comes and I'm banging on the door. He comes like, what? What do you want? I'm like, dude, I need some of that Cialis you got. We got whores coming. It's really important. I'm on coke. He's like, and then he did give me a Cialis. He was really upset, but he gave me a Cialis. So I pop, I'm like, all right, bring on the horse, right? And I just walked into my room to tell this stranger, good news, I got a dick pill, so we can do this. And then the escort showed up immediately. The second I came back up, they showed up. So this stuff has not worked yet, okay? And now things are moving really quickly. So two girls walk in. Both of them say A a lot, like this guy. He immediately grabs the better-looking girl. One of them's like kind of, I don't even know what background, you know, it's Canada, so she's probably like Lebanese and Dutch or some weird shit you don't see. You don't know any Lebanese Dutch people outside of Canada. But she was cute. And the other girl, she was pretty, but a little bit heavier. So he jumped on the less heavy one, okay? But whatever, I'm fine with that. The problem is, the Cialis is not kicked in yet. And as I'm looking at the girl, there's something like wrong that I can't put my finger on, okay? There's just something wrong with him. I'm like, all right. No, it's not. That would have been better. I know what you're thinking. It's not that. I see where this is going. That would have been a little bit less embarrassing. So he jumps on his. He just starts fucking immediately. And I mean, like, he's doing like the pile driver and shit. Like shit that nobody actually does, but you just see in porn. He's just doing on the living room floor. Well, I'm like, wow, your dick's amazing, dude. You did the same amount of coke I did. I'm sitting there like, maybe jerk it a second. And she's like, I'm like, you guys want some coke? I'm like, we don't do that. The two hookers are nice girls that don't do coke. Okay? So meanwhile, the guy, he sees I'm having trouble. So I think he's like, I'll just, it's probably because I'm here with this, you know, they're polite. And he's like, it's probably because we're in here. He goes, we're going to go in the other room. And I'm like, isn't that where Tim is? All right, go ahead in the other room. Okay, I find out later, he apparently just barged into Tim's room while he's asleep, said, hey, we're going to fuck on the end of the bed, okay? A complete stranger. Where's that, Tim? Tim doesn't even know me. So the guy, Tim's like, why don't you get the fuck out of my room? The call girl's like, we really apologize. This is very rude, eh? She had some nice manners. She's like, this guy, I don't know what his problem is. Meanwhile, there's no luck for me. It's still, They come back, I'm overhearing him like, I'm gonna come on your face, okay? And she's like, no, you're not. They're having an argument where he's gonna come. And I was like, guys, gotta keep it down. I gotta really concentrate on a thought that gave me a boner once, you know? So then I have that, like, that pathetic cocaine, half hard, like, yeah, it was like, that'll be $150, please. A nice half hard, pathetic jizz, and oof, and the girl picks up, takes the money, she goes, and they're getting ready to leave. She goes, that shit'll kill you, eh? And they walk out. Okay. So I'm like, all right, well, whatever. I mean, it was an experience. That's how I'm salvaging this in my head. I just paid $150 for something I could have done myself and probably had a better time with not a weird football player from Canada next to me. Okay, so sitting there, and he's like, all right, well, I'm going to take off. I'm like, cool. And then all of a sudden, I feel something, and I'm like, oh, wait, you can't take Cialis with coke. You're not supposed to mix that. You know that, right? That'll kill you. Also, poppers, gay guys in here, I see you. Don't take poppers and mix cocaine. Cialis and coke, dawns on me, can give you a heart attack. It's it's two things raising your blood pressure together. So they multiply. I don't know how it works, but it can kill you. So I'm sitting there like, oh my God, I'm gonna have a heart attack. I start panicking. Really bad on coke, okay? Loud enough that Tim wakes up again in the other room. The football player's like, okay, man, I could stay. Do you need me to stay? I'm like, don't leave me, dude. I'm gonna die. So I swear to God, this dude sits down and holds my hand while I panic. This strange football player, and then I get a full hard on. So I'm just sitting there with a full boner, praying to Jesus that I don't die. While this Canadian holds my hand. Yeah, that guy stayed the whole night. He stayed almost the whole night with me to make sure I was okay. And then he left. And, yeah, so I called Tim on my ride over here. I called Tim because I'm like, am I forgetting any, because he was there too. I'm like, am I forgetting any details of this story? And one was the girl being really polite when the guy tried to barge in. And the other was he was up all night listening to me and this jerk off tell our entire life stories to each other. Now, this is going back like 15 years, maybe. Tim remembers this guy's whole, I don't remember shit about this dude besides, I'll do coke, eh? That's a blank. Fucking Tim had to listen to us tell each other the most jerked off hopes, boogie nights, sad ending hopes and dreams. Yeah, and then on the way home, he made fun of me, and I'm very good friends with that guy now. And I feel confident I could knock on his door any time of night and ask for Cialis. I can tell you that for a fact. Thank you very much.
Kurt Metzger! Our last guest, I am so, so goddamn excited that she is doing the show. So without further ado, here is T.S. Madison, the Big Dick Man!
Thank you, Kevin, for that marvelous introduction. I'm not fucking you later anyway, bitch, okay? Brooklyn, hi! Oh my God. These people have brought me all the way from Atlanta, Georgia, honey, to tell y'all a story. Yes, Atlanta! Atlanta. Do you live here? Do you live here now? Y'all live here now? Y'all live here? Good, okay? Good. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, I want to come tell you a story about something that happened to me in my life very, very long. Well, not that long ago, because then y'all will figure out my age. But bitch, very long ago. I, for a living, I've done a lot of stuff. okay? And a lot of things that I may not be proud of, but bitch, it bought me that big giant house out there in Conyers, bitch. It bought me two Mercedes Benzes, bitch, so it did its job, right? Okay, now, when I go through life, what I like to tell people to do is be yourself. That's one of my taglines. You see it right there on that shirt, right there. Be yourself, bitch. That's one of my taglines. And I try to encourage people to be themselves so much because strange things could happen in your life and even after you die. I was about 20 years old, and a friend of mine died that I went to school with, you know, at the school, you know, and all the ladies used to talk about how handsome and fine and sexy and delicious and all this type of stuff he wasn't. And he just up and perished. You know how when people just up and perish, you're like, well, how he died? You know, I wanted to say on top of me, but, you know, but that wasn't the case, you know. And I'm living the South. I'm from the South. So being from the South, you know, we are Bible people, right? The Bible Belt down there. And it's so crazy how we are the Bible Belt and I end up having tits and a dick. Ain't that something? I always knew that Christian kids, people of the cloth children, always end up sucking dick. The girls and the boys. So, ladies and gentlemen, the gentleman died. And when he died, everybody was running around trying to figure out how. Like, what happened? What happened to him? Be that I'm a queen, honey, you know we nosy. We nosy bitches. So a girlfriend of mine and I, myself, loaded up in the car, honey. You know his funeral was Saturday. You can't keep black people out long, too long, honey. You know what I'm saying? You know, we can't keep them out too long, child, because the family will be fighting over the money. But anyway, we loaded up in the car. I'm trying to think here. I'm old. Now, y'all don't hold this against me. We loaded up here in the car, and we went to his services. So we sitting here in the back of the church, you know, and we watching everybody come in, The casket is sitting up there all pretty and white. The big spray is sitting up there. And, you know, the mom on the front row, the girlfriend on this row, honey, the kids is crying. Everybody is just crying and crying. It was a real sad occasion. And I'm still trying to figure out how he died. You know what I'm saying? Like, I'm sitting there like, how he died? Now, me and him around about the same age. I hope it ain't my time next, you know. But anyway, so we're sitting back here, and everybody's just chilling and just trying to figure out how he died. Because, you know, that's just the big thing. How did this man die? So all of a sudden, out of the blue, we're just sitting there, and the doors of the church just blew open. Poof. And we look back here. Now, this is a true story, okay? I'm telling you, this is a true story. We look back, and it was the first thing I saw was hair. You see how this hair is sitting up here on top of my head? The first thing I saw was hair sitting up to the ceiling, coming in through the door like this from the side. And when the hair came in, you didn't really get a chance to see the person. You just saw them holding themselves like this, and it was very much so, he took a good dick out. I was like, what? You know, he took a good dick out of this one. I said, what? She just kept coming from the back, hair to the side. Like this was a stage performance. So I nudged my friend like, girl, honey, are you sitting to the edge? Is this time for us to go, honey? Are they calling us out? So it just got louder and louder as she proceeded up to the goddamn cancer. He took a good dick out of this world. He took a good dick out of this world. He took a good dick out of this world. And I said, wait a minute, wait. Wait. Did this bitch just say what I think she said? And then, honey, you know, I guess I was not the only one that couldn't really understand what was coming out. So I guess the shit show and shenanigans just continue. He took a good dick out of this world. He took a good dick out of this world. He took a good dick out of this world. So I'm like, oh my God, he took a good dick out of this world. Oh my God. Like, out of all the dicks that I have ever had in my life, why couldn't I have that one before he went on to the glory? You know, and then, listen, y'all. Now, listen, this is some true motherfucking tea. I'm telling y'all, this is some true tea. This bitch was ugly as fuck. This bitch was so ugly. I know y'all seen the movie Holiday Heart, right? Y'all seen that? Holiday Heart with Ving Rhames. It's up in drag, bitch. Up in drag, looking like two men and a baby with this wig sitting on top of her head, screaming and crying. Now, see, mind you, this boy never touched any of the queens in the local neighborhood, never. Never touched them, felt like we were disgusting. Used to talk all kind of shit. Y'all some dudes, all y'all dudes. All y'all over there is dudes. I see y'all in the club, all y'all is dudes. So of course I was gonna go to your motherfucking funeral, bitch. You died first, bitch. The dude's still alive. But the gag of the matter was we found out that you were really fucking a dude, bitch, when you were alive, okay? Because this was a man, this wasn't like a, it wasn't a beautiful queen like myself, bitch. This was a man, like a man man, like a hard steel man with a fuqua sitting on top of his, a wig or something on the head, laying all down on the side of the casket. He took a good dick out of this world. He took a good dick out of this world. He took a good dick. He took a good dick out of this world. So I'm sitting there like, bitch, is that dick really that good? You would come all the way from wherever the fuck you came from and break this funeral up like that. How could you break a funeral up like that? So the baby stopped crying. The wife stopped crying. The mama stopped crying. Everybody is looking like, what the fuck is going on? You know, and this queen was really putting on a stage performance, bitch. Y'all hear me? With the he took a good dick. So I'm sitting there like, well, when is it gonna end? And she stood right up there to the front, everybody. He took a good dick out of this world. He took a good dick out of this world. He took a good dick out of this world. Rolled and went back and forth in front of the casket. I wanted to leave. No, I didn't, bitch, I'm lying. I wanted to see what the fuck was gonna happen. Bitch, so the pastor is standing there. Now, you know this is Southern Baptist church, bitch. This is Church of God and Christ type of church, y'all. Y'all already know them Church of God and Christ don't play none of that homosexual stuff. This queen came in there and turned the motherfucking party, bitch. You hear me? So my advice to men and women and down low men is please live your authentic truth. Live your authentic truth and mind how you treat people in this life, because you never know who may come to your funeral and turn that bitch out. I'm trying to tell you, because see, I learned something from that bitch that day. I'm gonna go fuck a bitch funeral up. He took a good dick. He took a good dick. He took a good dick out of this world. Thank y'all so much.
TS Madison, everyone! That is our show for tonight. Thank you so much to Seeso and the Comedy Show and of course the Bell House. Have a wonderful night, everyone!